Speculative history, what if history, is only valuable if it illuminates something about real history, whatever that is. So an argument can be made for a Southern senator being chosen as vice presidential candidate by a politically savvy New Englander with his eye on the White House. A Southern senator, maybe a decorated veteran with a well-earned reputation as a crusading prosecutor. Well, in 1960, a different Southern senator got the job because Sid McMath didn't make it to the Senate. He didn't make it to the Senate because of his commitment to the electric cooperatives of Arkansas at a time when Arkansas Power and Light could and did make and break political careers in the state. A promise made to folks trying to take electricity to rural areas un or underserved by APNL was enough to derail the rising political star of the photogenic governor of Arkansas. Skip forward 40 years to maybe 2000, and Joy Broach, a board member at Historic Arkansas Museum, where I have been the director since forever, told me about an autobiography that Sid McMath was working on. Wouldn't it be great to have an autograph party for the book? Now, among places that sell books, there is a friendly competition for first signing party. You just sell more books. And so I called Governor McMath and asked him if he would be willing to hold his first party at Historic Arkansas Museum. He would be happy to, and he thanked me for my invitation. Time passed, and the manuscript was almost done, and Governor McMath began to weaken. He was already blind, but his mind remained clear, and his family assisted him in the production of the book. But now the body was failing. I got a call from a mutual friend who suggested that maybe a larger venue, a better venue in some way, I don't remember exactly how he said it, might be best for the author's party. I like our museum as a place for almost anything, but I'm pretty philosophical about the way things work, and I understand that for some folks, bigger or brighter or more stately signifies weightier import. So I had no plan to protest, but I thought I would get a clarification. I called Governor McMath and I said that if he wanted to move the party, that would be fine with me. Bill, he said, do you know the name of my book? No, sir. It's called Promises Kept, and I plan on being at your museum for the first autograph party. Okay, I got the message, and I'm sort of impressed with this guy. Governor McMath had first entered my personal radar back in the 60s when he was an advocate for a war about which I felt less than enthusiastic. The government thought that I was of fighting age and that I could help out in Southeast Asia. Governor McMath stood front and center in my mind as the embodiment of that kind of thinking. That Major General in the Marine Corps Reserves thing seemed to overshadow the rest of him for me. But I had seen him give several speeches, the last being an impeccably presented talk at the old State House after he'd lost his sight. No notes, no braille, no hesitation, just a superb oration. He was growing on me. Phil McMath and the other family members facilitated the completion of the book, and while it was at the printer, the governor teetered on the edge. Would the book arrive from the printer on time? Would the governor live long enough to attend any author's parties? The family had taken him home from the hospital to die in a place of comfort and familiarity. Friday night came, and he still lived. Family members wheeled him onto the stage of the Ottenheimer Theater at the museum. A nice crowd, happy and tearful, relieved and surprised, greeted him enthusiastically, knowing they were seeing his last public appearance. I read a brief excerpt from the book, the one in which he chooses not to get along and go along with APNL. And he said a few gracious words, only intelligible if one was listening carefully how weak he was. Then he was wheeled away to the car and back home. He died the next day. In talking to Phil later, he told me that his father had the date of the museum's event circled on his calendar. There was no question about his intention to make the party, even as he was slipping away. It was as if Mr. Death arrived in his bedroom, and Governor McMath responded with sincere curiosity, "Do you know the name of my book?" I have mixed feelings about my role in all of this. I feel bad about holding him back from release and rest. Yet I had the privilege to see the power of personal honor defy, if only for a few days, our ultimate fate. His almost casual commitment to me was the last of his promises kept.